First, just a few words to explain my double affiliation, but I think it's very important. In Belgium, when you are retired at 65, you are obliged to stop to work. So I was glad to be invited to work in Estonia, and I will use a term that has been used already twice today. I feel it's sexy. Okay? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Estonia. But since I am here, I have not yet found the time to learn Estonian. I am just able to say tere, that's good. And as statistician or demographer, I may say yks, kaks, kolm, neli, viis, and okay, kymmen and sada. And sada is very important for me because this is longevity. Sada is longevity for me. That's why I know this. So let's try to start now. As you know, in one century, we gain 30 years more of life expectancy. At the beginning of the 20th century, it was no more than 50 years. And now we are above 80 years. And that's very important. We may say that today, every year, we gain 3 months of life expectancy. That's very crazy, but this is the real situation that the statistics show us. And if you look, and our good friend from OECD already shows some of these figures, we are now in EU 28 at 83 years of life expectancy for women and 77 for men. And if you compare this with the Estonian figure, you have 81 and 72. You see directly that the difference is larger for men compared to women. But the good point is that among all EU countries, Estonia is the one that gained the more important numbers of years during the last decade. 6.4 for women and 4.5 for men. So it's really in Estonia that in the whole Europe, the gain in life expectancy was the larger. Why is it so? It's clear that the medicine has a very important role. And not only the curative, but also the preventive. You have to prevent. Just there was a small problem with that we have seen in the OECD report that the duration of time, the time needed to reach the service of health may be larger in Estonia. But one point not to be forget is the density of population. The density of population is so low in Estonia that to reach the hospital, it's sometimes very long if you are in the countryside. That's very important. And there is also some improvement in older age. And that's very important because the quality of life of older age is better and better. And that makes for sure the longevity more visible in a country. So during the century, I will be quickly, but the nutrition change, you know, the infectious disease disappear. Then the penicillin arrived in the 50s and the famous so-called cardiovascular revolution arrived in more recently after 60. These are the main driver of the reduction of the mortality, not only in Estonia, but also in the whole Europe. And what about the comparison with other countries? So I use for the comparison Finland, Latvia, and also Japan, because Japan is the leader. So we need to see the three together. And this is the situation with the male on the left and the female on the right. This is mortality rates. The higher are the higher mortality rates. So you can see that the higher, the green light, I will show you the green light there. This is Latvia. Just below, this is Estonia. And then you have Finland, and then you have Japan. And this is men and women. The only thing that I want to point out is that there is a crossover there. You see this crossover? Which means that after age 90, it seems to be better in Estonia than in Finland. So this is something that seems to be very important. You have already some view on gender difference. We will come back on this. Now, if I go... Now, what is very important is that the difference between Estonia and Finland, it's the larger is between 55 and 70. But the recent gain did not succeed to decrease this gender gap. This is something that is a problem mostly for men in Estonia. So the situation between 55 and 70, there is still a too large gender gap. That's a problem. Now, if you look Estonia and Finland in terms of improvement, so you have two curves. The curves are 1 and 2 are for 2000, and this is 2013. So you have for sure here, this is Estonia, this is Finland. So Estonia did some improvement. You see, this is the women and this is the men, and they are more improvement in Estonia compared to Finland. You see, here there is no improvement. Why in Estonia you have big improvement? So really, these figures show that the improvement in terms of mortality in Estonia are the best. So this is a figure that is very largely used around the world. It's the record country in terms of life expectancy during the whole period from 1840 to 2000. And you can see that it has been Iceland, it has been France, it has been Sweden, and so on. And recently, all the last point are the green one. This is Japan. So Japan is the leader in terms of life expectancy in the world. They go up to above 86 for women in Japan. So what could be a challenger? Because, and this is a very new information that has been released in Washington just 1 month ago, is that Japan will not be anymore the leader very soon. Look, there are some challenger. And the most, okay, we forgot Singapore, because Singapore is a city, and a city is not exactly the same as other. But Korea is there. And look, the slope of Korea, so that we can expect that in 2018, Korea will present a better situation compared to Japan. That is very important news. This is a scope, okay? So now let's try to see Estonia. And I did some extrapolation. Okay, statistician, now that extrapolation may be tentative, and it's not always easy. But you have Japan female and Japan male that are for sure. This is the life expectancy, okay? So the two higher are the yellow. This is, excuse me. So this is the men, the women, and this is the men in Japan. And now we have the Estonian women and the Estonian men. So you can see directly that we may expect, if we do extrapolation, that in 2040, we will reach the level of Japan. That's the hope. This is for the future longevity, if the trends is exactly the same. You see the trends is quite linear, but we never know. But you can see on this that the Japan is a bit going down, is slowing. There is a slower rates of improvement in Japan. So, what is the possibility for the future? This is the distribution of the survival curve. What is a survival curve? You start with 100,000 people, they die, and so their number decrease by age to reach zero at above 100, 110, okay? As you see there, this one is the actual situation. And the future, there are three theories, three hypotheses. The first one is this one, is that we will go with a more important rectangular. You see, what does it mean if it became a rectangle? It becomes that nobody will die before 100 or 105, and then at 105, everybody will die the same day. This is the full rectangle, okay? But we are going in this direction, okay? Why? Because the extreme age at the bottom is not increasing, why you have some improvement at 70, 80, at 90. So this is the rectangulation. Then the next one is the postponement, which means that you postpone everything, which means that you increase the upper limit of life. It's not anymore 115. It became 125. And then everything stays similar, but it goes in this direction. And the third possibility is this one. This is a full extension. Full extension, which means that we will be able to live up to 150 years old. So there are three theories, and there are people supporting each of them. That's very nice in the science that we have several possibilities. If you look at the situation And you look the future of longevity, as we see that the mortality rates are decreasing, even at 100, even at 100, before it was 0.5, so one chance out of two to die during the next year. Then it came to 0.4, and now it's 0.33, only one chance out of three to die within the next year. So we may suppose that there is no upper limit of the lifespan. This is an hypothesis. And Vopel, showing this graph that I present you before, say we will continue the straight line. And so if we continue the straight line, it's impossible that we will have an upper limit, fixed upper limit. Just to give you an idea, the oldest woman in the world is Jeanne Calment, 122. But there is no other one above 120. And the oldest man was a Japanese who died quite recently at 117. So these are the two maximum age. And nowadays, I will show you the oldest girl in Europe. She is 116. So the second point is that we have this. When you go to the older age, the so-called Gompertz line function, this is the exponential increase of mortality, it goes down. And there is now a theory to say that after some time, there will be a plateau, which means that there will be no more increase in the risk to die. Why? Just because there is a selection. Those who have to die already die. And so those who are still alive may continue, okay? So this is another possibility. This is the famous mortality plateau, and we will have very soon on the 1st of June, at the 30th anniversary of the Estonian Association of Demographers, we will have Jim Vopel, who will talk about this. He is the most important defender of this plateau. But we are still looking for the plateau. And the plateau occurs after 110, 112. So can you imagine? You need a lot of people to be statistically significant with this story. So there are another group of researchers. And the leader is Aubrey de Grey. And Aubrey de Grey explained that there is no problem. We will live up to 1,000 years. He goes up to 1,000. Okay, sometimes he say 150. Because he say it's not a problem. Your arm is a problem. We will repair it. We will repair everything. And there will be no problem. In the US, they have this hospital where you may go and change everything. Okay, if you have an old car, and if you have already seen an old tire, if there is a break somewhere, you repair it. 5 minutes after, it will be problematic just nearby. So I'm not so sure that this theory, but okay. And then the third group is a fully different group, and then we go to the unhealthy behavior. Oshansky in the US say that because of obesity, because of smoking, because of all these unhealthy behavior, what will happen is that we are reaching a maximum of the age, upper limit of life. So you have three different theory, and that's very important to know and to compare and to progress. That's why we are progressing in the research. Now, extreme longevity in Estonia. So I'm very interested in centenarian, because centenarian are exceptional. So these are some figures. There was an increase. I will go directly to the graph. This is the data. You see different census and the register for the last figure. You can see the number of male and female centenarian. And then let us go back to these dancer. My colleagues say that there were six women for one boy. Look here. There are 10 female centenarian for one male centenarian. Can you imagine the matrimonial market there? Okay. Now I will tell you a personal history. I have an uncle, he was 98, and he entered in a nursing home, and every evening before to go to bed, he has to go in to visit 8 different girls to say, sleep well, sleep well. How can you imagine that this person will live up to 100? No, he died at 99. Okay, Now let's be a bit more serious and to say that living longer is a wonderful achievement for the mankind. Everybody is happy with this, but it has a lot of implication at society and at individual level. For example, and that's very important, adding years to the life. Isn't it better to add life to the year? That's a good question. Because, and you will see in one of my photography of the oldest from Europe, and it brings some problem. But just because, before that, I would like to say that there are for sure also socioeconomic conditions. The problem, socioeconomic consequence, the problem of the age at retirement is a very important topic where you have to put together demography, sociology, and economy, and so on, to see what is the best situation. But it's clear that in a lot of European countries, like in Belgium, due to the pressure of union, we were not able to change the age at retirement, what makes the situation sometimes difficult because people enter now later in the working age at 25, and they left in Belgium even before 60. So finally, the duration of the working life was very short. That's very important. But at the same time, we are suddenly facing a period of life where there is officially nothing to do. It's a non-working age, from 60 or 65 to 80. You are still healthy and you have nothing to do. Maybe to take care of your grandchildren, if any of them. Okay, so this is the big challenge for the society. What can we do? What can we offer as activity, as service for society for this age group that did not exist in the past? In the past, you finish your working life and you go directly to the cemetery, or you were already dependent. Now, suddenly, you have time. Some decide to travel, and they travel a lot. Some decide to learn English because their children are in the US and so on. But I think it's time to do something for the society. And that's something that our policymakers should understand, to promote this way of being active, still active from 65 to 80, and you are not yet dependent. So this is a big challenge. Now, just to say that if you look the older person now, I will say that they may do something, but when you arrive at 85, 90, depending, the age is not the best indicator, because I saw people at 105 that were still very active. So, but at one moment, these people does not want anything else than to die. So the last years of life, it's a very important problem. They may be in bad health, they may have some financial difficulty, and they may live alone, especially for women. And I would like to mention the fact that in Estonia, the situation is even worse, because I explain you the low density of population. How many women are living in the countryside alone? That's, for me, a very crucial point for future in Estonia. This is my good friend. So Emma Morano, on the left, she is 113. And on the right, we were together with Anne. We were there in last October. And I will still be to visit her next month, if she is still alive. She is 116. She is the second oldest on Earth and the first in Europe. Seems that there is a girl in New York, a black girl, that is just 2 months older. But on the left, I will say she feels happy. But when we visit her last October, I was a bit sad because she has nothing to do during the full day. She has no family, sometimes a niece come and so on. No. It's really the end of the life is something that we have to tackle, to consider very strongly how to make it a relatively good time for people. And everybody has to go through. That's very important. So we are in the gray revolution, we say. We are in the gray revolution. You see, I am also gray. This is not a problem. But the main paradox is that everybody is proud about longevity, including policymakers. I have not to repeat the fact that Stalin was putting on the top the longevity in Caucasus. He was very happy. Cuba, it's the same. Fidel Castro said that the longevity of Cuban is so exceptional. But at the same time, we are excluding the oldest old. We are excluding them. And even at the same time, we are considering people older, more young. When you are 50, you are already old, what was not the situation in the past. So at the same time, we live longer, and you are becoming older, younger. You see, it's a bit strange, eh? But put this in your mind, you will see. Okay, so I would like really that national and local authority, and I put a local authority also because they have a big role to do this. And then to finish now, two slides. This is a wonderful slide from Okinawa in Japan. I understand that everybody may read it carefully, okay? What is written there? And this is for the statistical office. When you are 80, you are just a newborn. When you are 90 or 95, you are a teenager. And when you are 100, you become adult. So this is for statistical office. And I have another one, wait. Look, this man. He was 112, Antonio Todi. I proclaimed it as the oldest man in the world in 2002. And he has a wish in Sardinia. So he is living in Sardinia. And the wish is Acantanos. Acantanos means, can you live healthy up to 100? So I will say that statistical office, I am sure you will survive to 100, no problem. Why it's not for human being, no problem. But maybe that for the statistical office, we have to revise the upper limit of life and to put. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mike. We ask for the question, if there is any. Kas kellelgi on küsimusi? Liitame.
Well, thank you for this excellent presentation. And my question is related to business, actually. So we are collecting here our pensions, and in many, many other countries as well. So there is a compulsory pension system in Estonia and by neighbors as well, so probably also in Belgium, etc. And now in one happy day, we are invited to the banks or insurance companies or fund managers, and they will have to calculate for us a lifetime pension. And in order to do so, you need a mortality table. 1 year mortality rate. But now the question will be, since the mortality rates are tremendously changing, what do you recommend to the life insurance companies? How should they calculate now lifetime pensions?
Ah, yes, I have to. Yeah. I have just one answer. We invite you to come the 2nd of June in the meeting that we will organize. There will be three presentations by actuarian about the upper limit of life and how to tackle this topic, because for them this is very, very important. And so we decide to put together for the first time actuarian and demographer, because they were dealing the same topic but never worked together. So there will be three papers presented at that meeting, and if you are interested, you just ask Lula. She will invite you. Thank you.